All right. So today, another episode of the LMS playlist. And we've got Randy Rebman joining us today. We're talking about more on the higher ed side of things with LMSs, which is fascinating because I have no familiarity really with that world. And so it's going to be kind of cool to discuss this. Before we get started, I did want to just show this list that I just got in my email from Training Industry. I'm going to share this with you guys. Can you see that, Randy, by chance? Mm-hmm. Yeah. So the training industry just released their 2020 top learning management system companies, their top 20 or their top learning management systems. I actually don't even know how many is in this list. I didn't even count it. But I was looking at this list. Hopefully you guys can see that okay. But it's really interesting to me because, for example, okay, so I see Docebo's in there, which we talked to Quetzal about in our first episode, and also with Tom McDowell too. So that's in there. No Talent LMS, no Exonify. And some of these folks, I am just surprised that they're even in there. I mean, Totara, yeah. Upside, sure. SAP Litmos, yeah, of course, SumTotal. But things like Wisetail, some of these other ones I haven't ever heard of. Cornerstone, of course, should be on there. And Biz Library, which I always thought was pretty much more of a content library. I'm just surprised to see some of those on there. Anyway, I just wanted to start out and share that because I thought it was kind of interesting to see this particular group. Now it is, you know, I'm not sure exactly how Training Industry collects these particular LMSs. Yeah, exactly, Quetzal. What defines top? Like, is this like you submit your name and then that way they can market you for a fee kind of deal? I don't know. I shouldn't, you know, assume that that's the case. But this is in alphabetical order, which is the way that it's listed on their site. And it's not in any particular order. And I don't know how much research has gone into it, but there's a top learning LMS, I mean, a top LMS list for everyone to check out. So let me go ahead and close this now. I'll stop the screen share. And so the LMSs we are talking about today, neither of them are on that particular list, which is also something that was kind of interesting. And we're going to move on to talking with Randy about Blackboard and Canvas, which I used Blackboard years ago, briefly, just played around with it. But since then, definitely have not touched it. I've, of course, been more on the corporate side of things. And Canvas, heard lots about Canvas, did a little research on it, saw that it was cloud-based, it took over market share on the higher ed side of things a couple years ago. So I think this will be really interesting talking to Randy about it. So Randy, if we can start out, maybe you were just on this last Friday, but maybe just introduce yourself a little bit and tell everyone who you are and what you're going to be talking about.
Sure. I'm dealing with something with my screen. It's not, it's acting up. So, so I, for about 10 years, have been in higher ed. And since recently leaving higher ed, I kind of jumped into the corporate sector. But I taught at two different universities, Oregon State University, and then more recently at St. Louis University. And both of those institutions, I used Blackboard, and in Oregon State, they transferred over to Canvas from Instructure about midway through the 4 years I was teaching there. And then when I came to St. Louis University, they were about midway through their process of beginning to adapt Blackboard. I think their research process kind of finalized, and then COVID hit, and that got put on the back burner. So it was like I went through the whole transition to Canvas and then came back and using Blackboard again with my new school. But so, yeah, now I'm in the corporate sector. So I left that behind fairly recently.
Nice. Okay. Wow. So have you been in the corporate sector before?
No, this is my first go around with it. Yeah.
All new to you. Awesome. Mm-hmm. That's what do you think so far?
I really like it. I think it's been quite a learning curve. I think it's just learning all the new software that go along with it and kind of new workflows has been something that's been quite an adjustment.
And I've heard that it feels like it moves faster. Definitely. That the case? Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that's an interesting topic. You know, we've talked a little bit about it on TLDC, you know, a few times. Like, of course, someone like Kara North, who just went from the Ohio State University to where she is now. That's something that she brings up on a pretty regular basis, and the difference between the two. So it's pretty fascinating. So other than Blackboard and Canvas, what other LMSs have you used?
I've played around with Moodle a little bit, and that's the open source LMS that I think a lot of people probably are familiar with. They've dabbled in higher ed, and I think even on the corporate side, sometimes that gets used. The other one, if I might just share my screen real quick, Louise, and share this this graphic that I took in Snagit. There's a article that came out, I think, in 2018, and the higher ed, the Chronicle of Higher Ed, and they looked at the different, let's see if I can put this up here. They looked at kind of the top LMSs at that time. This is July 6th, 2018. And Blackboard at that time had 28% of the market share. Moodle was at 23, and then Brightspace DL was at 12%, and then Canvas at 28%. I haven't looked at, I don't know, in your research, Louise, if you saw anything that was more current than this in 2018, but I think from everything I've looked at, Canvas has kind of taken over the market share for Blackboard and is kind of leading that race at this time.
Yeah, that's what I saw. And there were just so many different things about Canvas that that made an improvement over the experience of Blackboard. It just kind of overwhelmed Blackboard fairly quickly, I think.
Mm-hmm.
But Brightspace, wait, what, you called it Brightspace something? Did you?
I think Brightspace DL is what it's called. And that one, I have to admit my ignorance on. I've seen it in one training that I attended where I was played around with it a little bit in just terms of evaluating a course that somebody already created online, but I never actually used that one and I'm not really familiar with it at all.
Right, right. So one more time again, sorry, I missed it. The source on this graph?
This one is, I'll show this real quick and I'll actually drop the link in there. This is from, let's see. I think this is from Higher Ed, Inside Higher Ed. This is Canvas Catches and Maybe Passes Blackboard. So I'll just drop this in the chat so people can check that out. And that's where I got that graphic from. And but it seems like those are the three front runners, is Brightspace, Canvas, and Blackboard, and have been for quite a while in the higher ed sphere.
Now, are you using an LMS right now for your new corporate job? Is that something
No, I'm not using one currently. I'm just using a couple different software platforms that are kind of on demand. I think it's more on demand training than anything.
Because maybe somebody in chat could answer this one, or maybe you can, of course, Randy, but I'm just wondering, why is it that like they're so separate? Why is it that like the corporate LMS side of things is so different from the higher ed LMS side of things? Now, obviously Moodle is open source, and so you know, budget wise, Moodle is probably more affordable than a lot of what is being offered on the corporate space. But, you know, you'd think that feature wise and what the intended use of both would be, that they would, you know, they wouldn't be such like separate, you know, markets. So I'm kind of find that fascinating.
Yeah. And I'm not really sure what, you know, what really drives that differentiation, you know. I just know that from what I've used, it seems to be that just the user interface on Canvas is kind of what I think has made a lot of people turn that direction, and kind of the software as a service feature that they had.
Oh, that's really interesting. So if anybody else, if you guys in chat have any ideas, would love to see it, feel free to post in there. So Randy, your primary role with Blackboard and Canvas, what were you doing in there?
So I was an instructor. I wasn't an instructional designer, but I designed most of the courses for language programs when I was in Oregon State University. Mm-hmm. And oftentimes we didn't really have a template to work from. And a lot of programs, I think instructional designers within higher ed will have like their own template that they put out. I'll share one with folks that I really thought was really helpful. It's a hybrid template from Oregon State University when I worked there. And it's designed by a guy named Cub Khan, I think is his name. He's kind of the guru at Oregon State University in there. Hybrid and e-learning department. And what's nice about it is like they have a number of those templates and you can just simply import those into your course. And that's one of the things that I really liked about Canvas is you could take those templates through the Instructure. That's the organization that makes Canvas. And they have like just this whole catalog of courses. So once you create your course, you could save it and then let's say you and I are teaching similar courses. I just pass it off to you. You can mm-hmm. import all that in. You don't have right. to reinvent the wheel and have all that organized. So
yeah.
I thought it was really helpful.
So working with, you know, with Blackboard, was there anything you needed to be particularly good at being able to navigate through that and Canvas as well? Is there, mm-hmm. you need any special skills to be able to use those LMSs?
Not necessarily. I think, you know, one of the things with Blackboard was that it wasn't set up in the cloud. The version I had was self-hosted. And I think that what made it really difficult is that, you know, it was really clunky and you had to go through a lot more steps and processes in designing your courses in it. And so mm-hmm. I think that made, you know, in the support side, it wasn't as good as Canvas mm-hmm. in terms of the, and I think that's one of the reasons a lot of people went to Canvas was because of that. So that feature I think was made it really, really difficult. I think there was a lot of just accessing the grading. Like when you start an assignment and then put it into the grade book, like there was like three or four different steps and you had to organize them in certain categories. And it was just really clunky and it took a lot of extra steps. So I think that part was really difficult about it.
Yeah. Interesting. And so moving over to Canvas, the interface was much better. It was just easier to navigate, that type of thing. Just more modern looking. Is that?
Yeah. And actually I'll share my screen real quick here and mm-hmm. just show one of the nice things about all these LMSs is they give you kind of a trial where you can kind of just start your own account. Mm-hmm. So when I was taking an instructional design course at this is at Western Oregon University. I did a module that was kind of a sample in a course. And so this is looking at Canvas. This is the free version where you can kind of play around, kind of create it like a sandbox. Mm-hmm. And so over here, it's very minimalist. I mean, you could put more things in here. I kind of like this style. There's a guy, Michael Wesch, who's kind of a big name in online teaching. And I think he's the University of Kansas, perhaps. And he talks about just leaving in his Canvas site, having it very minimalist so that when people go into, they land in your course and they go into the modules. And what I like about this is you can easily drag and drop some of these down to the other one. Maybe it's not working for me here, but when I go into the editor and start editing, I can move these down. And the drag and drop feature is just really easy to use. Once you go in here, you can kind of click this next button. And so it's like navigation wise, whoops, I got out of it. Navigation wise, it works really well. It's mm-hmm. just super clean on that. So I think that was kind of one of the things that a lot of people liked about it. Mm-hmm. is just the ease of use for that.
Right. Is it something that was it a collaborative environment? Is that like you could share your content with other teachers? So, you know, when I think of LMSs in the corporate space, I feel like sort of multiple users or multiple authors is a little bit probably more common, like a team of instructional designers kind of working together to build whatever curriculum, but maybe not as common on the higher ed side.
It's not. And that's one of the things that I never really experienced a lot of coordinated collaboration. I think if I was an instructional design position in a higher ed, I think that would be kind of one of my goals, is trying to get instructors who are teaching a similar course to have more collaborative planning. Cause I think there's a lot of reinventing of the wheel, and it's like, if you can have a template and then maybe share content creation roles, like you're talking about, it would streamline a lot of that. And that's why I think Blackboard was really hard for any of that collaboration to take place. I think with their new version Ultra, which is their kind of their answer for Canvas after they started losing a lot of that market share, I think they have some of that tools built in where it's maybe easier to collaborate.
Yeah.
I did hop into Ultra a little bit, but it's not something I'm familiar with.
That's fascinating, because I do know that, like, when I would produce expos in the past, Blackboard would be a regular attendee, a regular exhibitor. Mm-hmm. And, but they wouldn't get near the attention that somebody like, say, Adobe would get, or SumTotal, or any of these other ones that are, you know, like Litmos, that are a lot more common in the corporate space. But it was always fascinating to me that they were still there. They were trying to get, you know, some corporate share. And and that's interesting. Okay. So let's just talk about, you know, overall, that's kind of a fantastic conversation altogether, is like the higher ed to corporate sort of transition. And especially, you know, like even in regard to these LMSs and sort of the way that you're, you know, sort of seeing things now. But let's just talk about that. So with Blackboard, you work with that. You work through a couple of migrations over to Canvas, right? So what started those migrations? Like, why did you even start looking for something different? Did you just hear that Canvas was better, or, Blackboard was just simply not working? How did that go?
I mean, that was internally through the kind of e-learning arm of our university. So I wasn't in on those conversations. I think as a department, we, kind of just followed suit with the rest of the university. And, I do think one of the big draws was just one is just not having the support in Blackboard and looking at some of those things that Canvas brought. I wasn't in on those conversations. I think, you know, if I was part of the e-learning group at the university and the instructional designers, then I probably would have been more privy to that. But
was it kind of a relief?
It was. I think, you know, the clunky kind of everything was in folders, and it was the way the modules worked in Blackboard, it was just, even when I was in graduate school, I remember having a hard time finding it, and the teachers or my professors, like, trying to find their files and stuff. And it was, even as a content management tool, it just was really clunky. And so
was that kind of the hardest part of working with Blackboard, is just the organizational issues?
Yeah, I think the organizational issues, and, you know, if there was updates, because, you know, it was self-hosted, they have to update the whole system. And so it'd be offline for a couple of hours. And then it was like, you know, students would say, well, Blackboard's offline, and like, I don't have to do my work tonight. You know, it's like they would always have that going on periodically. And, you know, when it was software as a service, like Canvas started out as, I think they just quickly kind of surpassed Blackboard because of that. And it was like, well, those updates just happen automatically, of course, once they make those changes.
Right, right. Well, how about authoring within the Blackboard environment? Was that, what was that like?
I when I first started, I was kind of doing the, you might call it the folder method, where you have this folder and then inside there's a series of tasks that the learners have to do. I kind of moved to, once I started working with the modules, trying to do that. But it just has, actually, I'm going to real quick do a screen share and I can show you this Blackboard site. Let's see, not that one. I thought I had it pulled up here. Yeah, so this is, I'm gonna pull up an Ultra course, or this is original course. So in Blackboard Ultra, they have just a foundation course here that is a shows you all the samples. But here in this side, like in the sidebar, they would have a whole bunch of features down here. And this is, of course, not the current version. But if you had, you know, like the modules and everything here to access them, it just got really confusing finding both. And sometimes they didn't really match up. So what I'll show here is just, this is a sample course. You can kind of see how it's laid out here. So this is like the Blackboard Ultra. So this is a better version. And so they're just kind of, they lay it out kind of visually in the same way that Canvas course was laid out. So I think they're trying to address just how clunky it used to be. So it's gotten better in this Ultra version that you see here. So if anybody decides they want to check out Blackboard, they can sign up and they'll get this access to Blackboard Ultra. But again, I don't know price-wise how that works. But again, I think the biggest thing with Blackboard was just, it was got really confusing, all the stuff on the left sidebar and then all the stuff in your content here. Sometimes like they just didn't work, you know, they just didn't really match up that well. And sometimes there'd be broken links and things like that. And it was really frustrating actually.
Yeah. It sounds like it. I don't know if you had to deal with it with Blackboard's Blackboard had, well, their online sort of presentation thing. I can't remember what it was called, but I used to use the, it was originally Illuminate and then Blackboard bought it. And so like sort of the webinar and presentation software package that Blackboard had was something I was familiar with, but it was always really, really clunky. So, you know, I don't know if that was something that you ever had to use, but it was kind of a pain for me to use it way back when.
Mm-hmm. No, yeah. I know that Blackboard and Canvas, I think Canvas has their Canvas Studio and Blackboard has their own version of that too. And they're doing their own kind of, you know, version of like, you know, video player in there that you can kind of a bare bones authoring tool, you know, those kind of things. I think they also have, Blackboard has a tool called Safe Assign, which will actually check students' work for like plagiarism. The other service called Turnitin is another one that sometimes used. So I think they've started to, you know, develop kind of a suite of tools to go along with the LMS. When I was at both those institutions, we never really had a lot of use of those. We always had these other aftermarket ones. I think Kaltura, Panopto were some of the video editors that we used a lot. So I guess, I don't know if that was an internal decision. It's just like, it's not such a good tool, so they use something else.
So tell me something that you liked about Blackboard. Anything?
Let's see. I'm trying to think about what I liked about it.
I'm asking the hard questions.
I, you know, just comparing the two, I didn't have a lot of things I liked about it. I think everything was so much easier from a user perspective on Canvas that I didn't really care for it.
So I think you went over a little bit of it already, just especially for the software as a service aspect of, you know, and updates and things like that with Canvas. But give us the rundown, like how much easier did it make your life, like going over to Canvas?
I think one of the biggest things is once we had, you know, the organization I worked at, we had people that had already developed courses and they would, you know, they build those courses up. Sometimes our managers would do that, and just being able to import all that content saved a lot of time. And that was, you know, one of the biggest things is being able to upload your course shell. We often call them course shells, where you'd have, you know, the modular layout, even maybe just like your objectives and stuff like that laid out too. And then you just kind of throw in the content and make little subtle tweaks. So that was by far like the biggest advantage that I saw, was being able to have that. And For some reason, the Blackboard version, I think it was Blackboard Learn 9 that we were using, it could have been even earlier, at the institution I just left, it was, you couldn't do that. You didn't have that option. And I don't know if that's changed in Ultra, Blackboard Ultra or not, but to me, that was like the number one thing that made it really easy. And then once you got in there and students started using it, you know, there wasn't really a lot of like confusion. It was like, okay, I can find everything here.
Yeah.
Cause it was just a very, well laid out, I think, in terms of the way the modules kind of flowed, and you can do that drag and drop too.
That's fascinating. I, you know, I'm really, really curious now about, you know, something like Canvas and the features that it has that might be a little more common on sort of the corporate LMS side of things. You know, I think that'd be interesting to kind of find out, you know, like, you know, was it something like Canvas said, look at all of these LMSs on the corporate side have these features that make it so user-friendly. Like maybe we should start taking, you know, that's where they kind of got their source, their ideas from, for UI or whatever, or UX from, mm-hmm. from these corporate ones and bring them into, into, you know, their product. But, yeah, I'd love to talk about that a little bit more. That's really, really, that's kind of an interesting concept. So Canvas altogether. Now you did a second migration. So you went through one. Did you end up like kind of guiding that second one, since you had experience from the previous one, or it was already just happening?
Well, it was just about, I think they were in their research process and gathering, because I think, I haven't been through one of these full migrations where you you're part of the research aspect of it, where you have, I guess it's like a call for proposals, and they give you quotes, and then you actually demo it, and then you kind of make a choice after that. So I think that process had been kind of almost completed, and then COVID hit, and so it never happened. So it was like we were gearing up for it, and one of the schools, I think it was the School of Medicine and the School of Professional Studies when I was at St. Louis University, they had actually adopted it, and they had been using Canvas for a while. So they already had people on that platform, mm-hmm. but the rest of the university just wasn't set up for it yet.
Yeah, that sounds like that's kind of a common mode is, if you're, say, you're on maybe a more legacy type of LMS and you want to migrate to a new one, you kind of do that migration in steps. Like mm-hmm. you only migrate over certain departments over to it, and you kind of keep your legacy one still running that might support, you know, your general organization, and then just, you know, keep on incrementally doing it. So that makes sense. So is there anything in particular, like if somebody said, oh, you've migrated from Blackboard to Canvas a couple of times, do you have any suggestions? Like, what would you suggest to a person that is looking to do something similar?
Let's see. I think I would probably start by looking at what are the big needs? What are you kind of looking, the differences maybe that, or maybe what's not really working with the platform you currently have. And I suggest really just signing up for one of the free courses and maybe mm-hmm. getting everybody to kind of play around with it. Because that's really what I did before I went and would train people on it. I would kind of get in it and just use it as kind of a sandbox, and then maybe take a couple features, import videos, and, you know, if you got some SCORM files, maybe upload some SCORM content and things like that, and just see how it performs.
Were you able to like import a bunch of stuff from Blackboard into your Canvas, whatever, you know, containers, or was it something you had to rebuild?
I just rebuild it all. Yeah, I had everything kind of stored in the cloud through, you know, through like OneDrive. And so I just uploaded that right here, Google Drive.
Uh-huh.
But so, yeah, I have not really got into, you know, if you develop something in Storyline or Captivate or even Camtasia and then, you know, upload one of those SCORM packages, or I haven't really dived into that. And well, they didn't even really use those editors. A lot of times they use just the like Panopto, where it's you would have a quiz, like a video, instructional video, and then maybe you do embedded quizzing. Mm-hmm. And so that would be kind of as complex as most of the editors that the universities would offer. And mm-hmm. I think that's still pretty standard, I think.
Interesting. Wow, very cool. All right. Well, you know, it's like what I'm hearing is Canvas is definitely better than Blackboard. And making the migration is, you know, is worthwhile. Mm-hmm. I'm sort of I am interested in Blackboard Ultra and just sort of seeing what those guys have you know, sort of up their sleeve. It seems like they'd want to continue to keep to compete. And so is Blackboard, did they move to a SaaS offering too, or is it still kind of a local?
That's what Ultra is, their SaaS offering. And so that's their answer to that. And I was researching just a little bit because we didn't have that service when I was teaching and using it. Mm-hmm. But I think it's, you know, it is one of the things that they're doing to kind of keep people on Blackboard is being like, okay, well, now you can move to SaaS. But I haven't really used it myself, so I can't speak to it from an user perspective.
Interesting. Okay, cool. Well, it's good. I'm glad that we're able to talk about like, you know, some LMSs from the higher ed side of things. Mm-hmm. It's sort of a fascinating difference between the corporate and the higher ed side. You know, I'm thinking that it'd be fun to be able to talk more about that with somebody that might have experience from both. And mm-hmm. So now let me just ask you, and this isn't really LMS stuff, but your transition into the corporate world, give me like a rundown, like what so far has been challenging about it?
I think one of the more challenging parts is just like all the new software programs just different ways of, I guess, different workflows and figuring out who's involved and all that. And I think when I was teaching in higher ed, it was very much like, okay, like a little bit more individualized. And one of my complaints that it was often in higher ed, it did feel like it was very siloed workflow. Like you would work on your own course and maybe you collaborate a little bit on some things. Yeah. But on the corporate side, it's like pretty intense collaboration where I'm, you know, on meetings pretty much half of my day. And then I have little work projects I have to carve out time for. So I think just adjusting to that and just all the new software has been pretty overwhelming, but I mean, it's good stuff.
Yeah. One of the things that I heard was that when you're working in higher ed, when you're done for the day, you're done for the day. But on the corporate side, when you're done for the day, you're probably still doing a little bit of work, or you're taking some of it like to save in the evenings, especially now with, you know, everybody being remote. But is that the case? Would you say that's accurate?
I felt like I was taking a lot of work home in higher ed. And I think a lot of it was, you know, student concerns, and I had different time zone issues. And so I could choose just to like shut it off. But oftentimes, you know, I think there was this unspoken expectation that you were going to be available, especially for students, and issues come up. And, it, you know, especially with the LMS, sometimes there would be something that, you know, I hadn't set the permissions right or something. And even after using it for a long time, I still had those mistakes. Mm-hmm. And so I felt like I had to be kind of on call even in the evenings. And with COVID, that got even more ramped up. So now I feel like actually it's the opposite, where I'm right now, at least during the onboarding process, I'm able to kind of like separate.
Right. So it's fairly new.
But I think that will change a little bit. And I think, you know, I just talked to my boss today. We got a lot of work projects coming up, so I may be taking some work home.
Well, I think his for me, my own experience is there are always a lot of work projects coming up. So. Mm-hmm.
Definitely.
Right when you think it's slowing down, it's like, oh yeah, we've got a lot of stuff coming up. So I know it seems like it's slowing down, but mm-hmm. you know, and it's like it's kind of a cycle of always getting busier. All right. This is very cool, Randy. I'm glad we're able to talk about this, and hopefully some of this information will help folks in the playlist about Blackboard and Canvas, because the higher ed side of things is kind of a different animal. And I'm not familiar with a lot of it. I've heard a ton about Canvas. In fact, I don't know why, I used to get confused between Canvas and then the tool Canva. For some reason, I thought they were the same thing for the longest time, which is totally silly. But now, you know, I, especially after doing this research, I understand a lot more about both Blackboard and Canvas. Mm-hmm. And thanks for sharing that graph and I mean that chart in the beginning. You know, didn't really realize it makes sense that Moodle would have such a big chunk of it, but mm-hmm. Brightspace I'd never even heard of. So
yeah, I don't either.
That's something worth looking into.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and one thing I would say is, you know, if anybody is, you know, going into a position as an instructional designer in higher ed or you know, on the job hunt, and they wanted to kind of dive into that, it might be worth just, you know, signing up for the free versions of one of these and building out some modules for some mm-hmm. type of content, and then including that in the portfolio, just to be able to say, look, I'm familiar with Blackboard and Canvas, you know, some of the leading LMSs, and because I've seen on job ads where that's something that has been requested.
Yeah. And I think it seems like too, just sort of looking at Blackboard and Canvas, there's less focus on things like performance support, which, you know, corporate LMSs, I think would be, you know, they would have more of that focus and micro learning, you mm-hmm. know? So I noticed that. So it's interesting to watch both. Okay, cool. Mm-hmm. Well, this is great, Randy. Thank you so much for taking, time out of your day to talk with us about this, and hope you're enjoying Anchorage over there. Definitely. You got your first snow of the day. I mean, snow of the year so far.
We had another one about a week ago, and this morning we had a little bit of one, but I think it's rained off so far, but we're definitely getting in the 20s and 30s.
Ooh. Yeah. Wow. Yeah. I'm still in up here in Northern California. We're under fire warnings again. So mm-hmm. I'm dealing with all that stuff. Oh, well, that's life in NorCal now.
Yeah. Well, hopefully they won't reach you. Fingers crossed. Yeah.
All right, Randy. Thanks a lot. And thanks, everybody, for popping in and joining us today. We do have a community showcase tomorrow. This one is with Chris Syracuse. And Chris is actually in Orange County or Orange, California. I'm a little worried because I know that over there they've actually gotten a huge fire that is going on. Can't remember what it's called, the silver something fire, but it just started last night. So I'm going to reach out to him, make sure he's okay. But otherwise we have him at 3 p.m. tomorrow and another afternoon one. So join us for that. He's like a graphic designer and illustrator, has a real creative background. So it should be a fun conversation. All righty. Thanks everyone for joining us. And thanks again, Randy. We'll talk soon. I'll see you offline.
All right.
All right. Take care.